call to discipleship, how God is calling you not just for a goosebump experience and encounter. People come by the thousands to Divine Retreat Center for just an encounter, for an experience. But friends, let me tell you, I've been now in ministry for 24 years. I've seen people come, people go. I've been full-time for 24 years. People come, people go. But the sad reality is this. Everyone who comes looking for an experience goes back empty. Maybe they have some kind of healing, okay? Some kind of encounter. But after 3 days, 5 days, 7 days, the encounter is gone. They are back to square one again. They are back to square one again. And honestly, friends, can I tell you the truth? Can I tell you the truth? Yes. Are you mature enough to handle the truth? Yes. Say out loud, Jude. Out loud, Jude. Tell me the truth. Yes. Okay, since you asked, I will tell you. Okay? The truth is this. After 7 days, their experience is gone. You are back to square one, but not only are you back to square one, the same problem will come back to you, this time more vicious than before. Have you had this experience? Yes? It'll come back with a vengeance now. Why? Because you have not moved on. You had an encounter that was great, but you cannot keep running to Divine Retreat Center every year. Every month, every week. You cannot live here. You need to move on. You need to grow. Tell the person next to you, you need to grow. Unfortunately, many Catholics do not grow. They are 40, 50, 60, 70 years old, but they are still sucking thumb. They're still sucking thumb. They have not grown to maturity. Spiritual maturity. They do not know the word of God. They do not know the teachings of the church. They do not know the teachings of the magisterium. And because of that, when the problem comes back, they cannot handle it. Look here. It's just not me saying it, okay? It's just not me saying it. Turn with me to 2 Peter. I want you to see this for yourself. 2 Peter chapter 2. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 17 onwards. Let me read that for you. This is Peter speaking, yeah? And he says, these are waterless springs, mist driven by the storm. For them, the deepest darkness has been reserved. For they speak bombastic nonsense. Isn't that so good? Bombastic nonsense. And with licentious desires of the flesh, they entice people who have just escaped from those who live in error. Verse 19, they promise them freedom, but themselves are slaves of corruption. For people are slaves to whatever masters them. Verse 20, listen very carefully. Verse 20, repeat after me. For if, after they have escaped the defilement of the world, through the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled in them and overpowered. The last state has become worse than the first. Listen carefully. If they have escaped the defilement of the world through the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and are again entangled in them, then the last state becomes worse than the first. So you came for one retreat and you said no to Johnny Walker. No more Johnny Walker in your life. You kicked out Johnny Walker. You go back after the retreat. Guess what's the first thing that's going to come back to you? Johnny Walker. And if again you fall back to Johnny Walker, your last state will become worse than the first. Your last state. If before you have a problem with woman, woo, baby, 36, 24, 36. Cannot say no to woman. Then you come for retreat and you repent. You fall down and you cry. When you go back after the retreat, what's the first thing that will come back to you? Woman. And this time, if you are not grown into maturity to be able to handle it, and if you fall again, your last state will be worse than the first. You're suffering from cancer because you cannot forgive. Forgive your husband, your wife, your mother-in-law, your father-in-law. Cannot forgive your dog, your cat. During the retreat, you forgave. After you go back, guess who's going to come to you? Your mother-in-law. She will come and she will dig you. She will dig you. And you go back to that anger. You go back to the hatred. Your last state will be worse than the first. Whoa, you wish you hadn't heard this, huh? But this is reality today. This is the reason why people don't grow into maturity, because they are stuck. So you see, friends, it's great you are coming for a retreat, but more than the retreat, there must be spiritual maturity. Peter goes on to say, it is the same as the dog turning to eat its own vomit. The dog turning to eat its own vomit. This is very important. So you need to grow. You need to move on spiritually. You need to learn the word of God. You need to be equipped with the word of God. You cannot have baby food anymore because you are no longer babies. When you came for the first retreat, yes, you were a baby. But after the first retreat, you need to grow into spiritual maturity. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 11. The writer to the Hebrews says this, I have much to say that is hard to explain, since you have become dull of understanding. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you still need someone to teach you again the basic elements of the oracle of God. You need milk, not solid food. For everyone who lives on milk, still being an infant, is unskilled in the word of righteousness. Verse 14, but solid food is for the mature, for those whose faculties have been trained by practice to distinguish good from evil. You see, friends, it's just the encounter is great, but it's much more than the encounter. You need to move on in your spiritual walk with God. You need to be able to discern the voice of God in your life. John 10, 27. My sheep hear my voice and I know them and they follow me. You need to be able to discern the voice of God. You need to be able to know the word of God in your life. The scriptures must come alive to you. All scripture is profitable for teaching, for training, for correction, for growing in righteousness. The word of God must be normal part of your daily life. You need to grow into spiritual maturity. And unfortunately, there are many Catholics today who have not moved on. Not moved on. They just remain at the encounter, remain at the healing, remain at the blessing. And they continue to seek for more and more blessing. By this time, you have attended 3 or more retreats. Am I right? Yes. The writer to the Hebrews says, by this time, you ought to be teachers of the word. Say amen. Amen. Tell the person next to you, you ought to be a teacher. You ought to be teaching other people the word of God. Amen? Amen. So next time, don't keep coming back to retreat center. The point is this. You need to go out and evangelize all of India. No, amen? Amen. Can you do it? Yes. You should be one going out to evangelize all of India. But if you still keep coming back to Divine Retreat Center and still keep sucking your thumb, you will never grow into spiritual maturity. You need to move on from milk to solid food. Milk to solid food. This is the reality with so many Catholics, friends. There are five stages of faith. And I just want to share with you these five stages of faith, Catholic faith development. Stage number one is inherited faith. These are people who are born into a traditional, conventional Catholic family. They receive their faith because their father and mother are Catholics. They are born into a traditional Catholic family. Stage number two is conventional faith. They grew up in an environment where the family is Catholic. They say the rosary. They go for mass. They experience the sacrament. It's conventional faith. There are devotions, and they go through the devotions. But many Catholics remain from stage one to stage two. Go to Philippines, for example. Many are inherited Catholics, conventional Catholics. But ask them the word of God, they have no clue. Ask them the teachings of the church, they have no idea. Because they remained at level one, level two. Then comes level three, which is seeking faith. Seeking faith. A crisis happens in their life, and after the crisis, they are looking for some meaning, some purpose. And during the meaning, the purpose, they have a God experience. God reveals himself to them. They encounter the touch of God. Have you encountered the touch of God? Yes or no? Yes. You have experienced stage three. After that, goes to stage four. Owned faith. Stage number one, inherited faith. Stage two, conventional faith. Stage three, seeking faith. Stage four, owned faith. Now, you are Catholic not because of your parents. You're Catholic not because of circumstances. You own your faith. You are ready to die for your faith. You are hungry for God. You seek the word of God. You seek the sacraments. You spend time in prayer. It's your own faith. You are hungry for God. And then comes the very important aspect, stage five, shared faith. You need to give it out to somebody else. Stage one, what was stage one? Stage two. Stage three. Stage four. Stage five. Shared faith. That means you need to start sharing your faith with somebody else. Whatever you have, your five loaves, your two fish, you start giving to somebody else. Your experience of the word, your listening to God, whatever God is speaking to you, share that. You share your faith. That is mission. That is growing into spiritual maturity. Unfortunately, many Catholics do not go to level number five. They remain at one, two. Some of them go to three, have a good experience, and stay at three. They do not move on to owned faith. They do not move on to shared faith. This is the reality of the Catholic world today. Okay? Out of 7 billion world population, Catholics account for 1.2 billion Catholics around the world. Say amen. Amen. That's a lot of Catholics. But unfortunately, out of all these, the majority of Catholics are cultural Catholics. Cultural Catholics. Why are they Catholic? Because their grandparents were Catholics. You have them here in India, cultural Catholics. Yes? Everybody is Catholic. There's a part of India. Everybody is Catholic. Everywhere you throw a stone, it will hit a church. Is there any part like that in India? Where? Kerala. Yeah. Goa. Yes. Everybody is Catholic. Everybody has a Catholic name, a Catholic identity, cultural Catholics. Then we have a second category, non-practicing Catholics. I call them ECG Catholics, Easter, Good Friday, and Christmas Catholics. Only three times a year they come for Mass. Easter, Good Friday, and Christmas. ECG Catholics. Whenever there is a crisis, they come for Mass. That's about it. They are the hatch, match, dispatch Catholics. They come to church when they are hatch, when they are born. They come to church when they are match, when they get married, they come to church. And the third time in all their life, they ever come to church when they are dispatched. When they die, somebody else will carry them to church. Hatch, match, dispatch Catholics. This is the non-practicing Catholics. Then category number three, we have the nominal Catholics. Catholic by name. Every Sunday, he's sitting in the pew. Have you seen this Catholic? Every Sunday. And you know what? This Catholic is sitting in the same spot every Sunday. If somebody else sits in his spot, he will go there and give a stare at that fella. Don't you know? This is my church. You know, that brick belongs to me. I paid for that brick, you know. And every Sunday I sit. I come for the 6:30 p.m. Mass and I sit in this spot. Who are you now? You are sitting in this spot. His biggest contribution to the church, for 1 hour he warms the pew for on Sunday. That's all. That's his biggest contribution. There's no other contribution. He is a nominal Catholic, a Catholic by name. Then we have the disciples. Then we have the disciples. These are genuine followers of Jesus Christ. Genuine followers of Jesus Christ. They have given their lives to Jesus Christ. They have accepted the Lordship of Jesus Christ. They had an encounter. They had a God experience. Now Jesus drives their life. Their life has a purpose, has a meaning. The big question is this. Are you a nominal Catholic or are you a disciple? Ask the person next to you. Are you a disciple? This is the reality. I minister a lot in Europe. I preach a lot in Europe, both Eastern and Western Europe. And it's amazing. I preach in a country that is a former communist country called Slovakia. It was formerly Czechoslovakia. And then Czech Republic and Slovakia broke off and they became two separate nations. Czech became an independent country with the capital called Prague. And Slovakia became an independent country with a capital called Bratislava. I minister a lot in Slovakia. And it's very interesting, very strong Catholic tradition. The whole country has a population of 5.3 million Catholics. No, 5.3 million total population. Out of this, after they came out from communism, 3.7 declare themselves by paper to be Catholics. Out of 5.3 million, 3.7 declare themselves to be Catholics. Out of 3.7 million, weekend mass attendance is only 780,000. 780,000. Estimated 3 million people don't go for mass on a Sunday. How do you know this? How can we calculate weekend masses? By distribution of Holy Communion. By the amount of Holy Communion that is given to a particular parish and the amount of Holy Communion distributed, we can gauge estimate amount of number of Catholics that are going for mass per Sunday. And the number is 780,000. 3 million, where are they? Where are they? Sleeping. 3 million Catholics are sleeping. They didn't go for mass. Out of 780,000 who are coming, many of them, 90% are pew warmers. They are just warming the pew. How many are disciples? How many are genuine disciples? Only the Catholic Church in Slovakia estimates only 150 million are genuine disciples. My God, this is a very bad state for the Catholic Church. Don't you think so? We are big in numbers, but when it comes to real, genuine disciples of Jesus Christ, we are nowhere. We are nowhere. We are still infants, like the writer to the Hebrews says, drinking milk, looking for feel-good experiences. We need to move on. We need to move on. This is reality in Europe. I used to live in a Catholic country called Malta. Malta is south of Italy, just 45 minutes by boat from Sicily and 45 minutes by boat from Libya. 80% of the country consider themselves Catholics. But the number that truly go for mass, the number that are genuine disciples of Jesus Christ? Very, very small. Why is this happening, friends? Because people, many Catholics have a desire for an encounter, an experience to feel good. But they don't want to move on further than that. They don't want to become disciples of Jesus Christ. And to become disciples, there is a price to pay. They don't want to pay the price for discipleship. Who is a disciple? The Greek word for disciple is mathetes, which means apprentice. A disciple is an apprentice, one who walks, talks like the master, who has the persona of the master. Unfortunately, many Catholics are not disciples. They are going after a tradition. You know, there is a story told about a guru. One day, he had 10 disciples, okay? This guru had 10 disciples, and he would sit under a tree, and he would teach the disciples. This guru had 10 disciples, and he would sit under the tree to teach the 10 disciples. And every day, he would teach the disciples. One day, there was a cat that came in and disturbed the teaching. Meow, 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 the cat came in. And the guru was so upset with the cat, he chased off the cat. Shoo, shoo. The cat went off and after 3 minutes came back again. Meow, meow, meow. He chased off the cat again. And he kept on doing it 5-6 times. The cat refused to go. So he told the disciple, catch hold of that cat. Tie the cat by the tail and hang it on the tree. And after you hang it on the tree, I will continue my teaching. So one of the disciples caught the cat, tied it by the tail and hung it to the tree. And the cat was screaming throughout the entire teaching. Meow, 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 meow. But the master said, let this be a lesson that you learn how to concentrate despite the noise of the cat. So he continued to teach. After the teaching was over, they let go of the cat. The cat ran away. Next day, they came and sat at the same spot for teaching. Guess what? The cat came back again. And the disciples caught the cat and tied the cat to the tree. And for 1 hour, the cat was going meow, meow, meow. And the teacher was teaching them. After 1 hour, they let go the cat ran away. Next day, again, it happened. Same thing, they caught the cat, tied it to the tree. Every day, carried on. Day after day, week after week, month after month, they would tie the cat to the tree. One fine day, the guru died. And the disciples went to all parts of the country to evangelize the teaching of the guru. And they gathered for themselves disciples. And they said, this is what my guru taught me. Before I start teaching you, I must find a cat and I must tie the cat to the tree. And while the cat is screaming, then I will teach you. Do you understand what the moral of the story is? The original purpose is lost. They get caught in a rut, in a structure, and they have missed the passion with which it was originally done. This is what has happened to us. Many of us are not disciples of the master. We are doing it because somebody said do it. We have not learned from the master himself. We are not apprentice of the master, a real disciple of the guru. That is why many Catholics cannot move on in their spiritual life. They will keep running for healing. After 20 years, they will still be running for healing. If you grow into maturity, you don't have to run for healing anymore. Say amen. Amen. When you grow into maturity, the power of God begins to flow through you. You experience healing. Say amen. Amen. When you have grown into maturity, you don't have to look for somebody to lay hands over you. Say amen. Because you can discover the healing of God flowing within you. Amen? There are 5 principles of discipleship. 5 ways to distinguish whether a person is a disciple or not. To find out whether truly you are a disciple or not. Number 1, a disciple is one who puts Jesus above everything else. Above husband, wife, child, above his own ambitions, his own desires. Jesus said very clearly, Mark chapter 8, verse 34 to 38, if you love me, you will follow me. You will leave everything else and follow me. Leave everything else. He has to be the first one. Put Jesus first. Number two, a disciple is one who at all costs will follow the teachings of Jesus Christ. Do you follow the teachings of Jesus Christ? Even better still, do you know the teachings of Jesus Christ? What Jesus is saying to you? Or better still, what do you listen? Many Catholics only do what they like. Jesus said, love one another. Okay, that is okay. So I will love one another. Jesus said, forgive your enemy. Okay, that one I don't like. So I don't like to follow that. So you pick and choose what you like and what you don't like. But a true disciple is the one who follows the teachings of Jesus. If you love me, you will do what I command you. John 8, 31 to 32. Number three, a disciple is one who bears fruit. Ask the person next to you, what kind of fruit do you bear? What kind of fruit do you bear? Jesus said very clearly, the tree will be known by its leaves. The tree will be known by its branches, by its fruit. If you see mango hanging on the tree, you know that the tree is a mango tree. Say amen. A mango tree cannot produce durian. A mango tree can only produce mango. What are you producing? Ask the person next to you, what are you producing? It's very simple, friends. It's not about how much healing you experience. It is about how much fruit you produce. On the final day, you will be judged based on the amount of fruit, not by the amount of retreat you attended. Jesus is going to ask you, where is your what? Fruit. That time, Jesus, I don't know, Jesus. I left it there behind, Jesus. Sorry, Jesus. I forgot my fruit, Jesus. Finish. You are finished. You are gone. You will be judged by your fruits. What kind of fruits you have? Number four, a disciple is one who loves God and others unconditionally and sacrificially. Jesus himself said that, John 13, 34 to 35. You will love him above everything else, and you will love your neighbor as yourself. So love is the mark of a disciple, not whether you have healing or not. There are many people who say, brother, but I have the power to heal the sick. Praise the Lord. Brother, I have power to raise the dead. Praise the Lord. But at the end of the day, that is not what is going to count. At the end of the day, whether you have love. You can heal the sick, raise the dead, but if you have no love, you are nothing but a noisy gong. Paul says, noisy gong. So friends, you will be characterized by your love. But brother, I come for retreat every week, every month. Once I come for retreat, brother. I've come for 364 retreats, brother. Praise the Lord. Good for you. How's your relationship with your husband? Brother, that man is crazy, brother. I cannot love him, brother. I want a meeting to kill him, brother. Finish. You are finished. All your retreats is for nothing. You are wasting your time. Don't waste your time. Brother, I cannot forgive my wife, brother. She's a useless woman, brother. She doesn't do any work in the house, brother. Go and love your wife first. That's where your call is. Say amen. But brother, never mind. I will just come here. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hello, your hallelujah is of no use. Okay. You can say hallelujah all you like. But this person next to you, you cannot love him. You cannot see Jesus in him. That's, you're no disciple. Matthew chapter 7 verse 21 to 23, Jesus says, not all who call me Lord, Lord will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only those who do the will of my Father. Jesus says, on the last day, many will come and say, Lord, did I not cast out demons in your name? Did I not heal the sick in your name? Did I not do works of wonder in your name? And Jesus will say, depart from me. I never knew you. Lord, your Lord, please don't say that, Lord. Finish, you're finished. And the last criteria for a disciple is one who makes disciple. A disciple is one who makes disciple. Say that with me. Say that again. How can you make disciple if you yourself not a disciple? Ouch, so painful. How can you make disciples when you yourself not a disciple? So if I use this criteria, very easy for me to check if you're a disciple. Simple question I ask you. How many disciples do you have? Brother, brother, I got no disciple, brother. Why no disciple? Nobody follow me, brother. Praise the Lord. Why nobody follow you? Oops. Finish. A disciple is one who makes disciple. Jesus gave the mandate to his disciples. Matthew 28 verse 19. Go therefore make disciples of all nations. Say this with me. Go therefore make disciples of all nations. Make disciples. Do you understand English? How do you make something? How do you make something? How do you make? Huh? With something, yes? How do you make something? Okay, example, idli. What do you have? Idli. Idli? Is that right? Idli. How you make idli? Huh? Rice? Dal? Yes? Rice and dal. Yeah? You know how to make idli? Yes? How many of you made idli before? Yes, exactly. You cannot sit down at the table and idli will fall from heaven. Bloop. No such thing. You have to make idli. Am I right? And in order to make idli, you have to take all the ingredients and make it, create it, form it. Not just one. Combine ingredients together and make it. Similarly, if you are a disciple, you need to go out and take all the ingredients in a person and make him into a disciple. That's how I know if truly you and I are disciples. The end of the day, you have no disciples, clearly shows that you and I are not disciples. But it's such an important message, friends. Honestly, let me tell you, this message is more important than all the messages over there. You know why? Because all that are feel-good messages, and it's great for an initial encounter for stage 3 or just now. But you are at stage 5. And you need to move on. Because if you do not, then guess what? What I read to you in Peter just now, that's going to happen all over again in your life. And I just want to close with these words of Pope Francis, okay? Let me just close with these words of Pope Francis. Pope Francis, when he took his office as the Pope on the 14th of March, he celebrated his first Mass, and in his first homily, in 14th of March 2013, Pope Francis said these words: "Yes, we can walk as much as we want, we can build many things, but if we do not confess Jesus Christ, we avail to nothing. We will become a charitable NGO." He's talking about the church, huh? The church will become a charitable non-governmental organization. Just a good organization, nothing more than that. No impact to change lives. But not the church, not the bride of Christ. The one who does not profess Jesus Christ, the one who does not pray to God, actually prays to the devil. Whoa. Pope Francis' words, huh? Don't get angry with Jude Antoine. Get angry with Pope Francis if you don't like it. He says, by default, if you are not a disciple of Jesus Christ, then guess what? You are a disciple of the devil. No two ways. Then he goes on to say, the one who does not profess Jesus Christ professes the worldliness of the devil, a demonic worldliness. Imagine now, this guy, first time became Pope, you know. All the guys sitting there listening, all the cardinals are in a state of shock. Oh my God, what is he talking? He hasn't finished yet. He goes on to say, when we walk without the cross, when we build without the cross, when we profess Christ without the cross, we are not disciples of the Lord. We are worldly. We can be bishops, priests, cardinals, popes, but not disciples of the Lord. Wow. Can you imagine the shock that was there? Yeah, you should be clapping at that point. Clap, friends, clap. Not the words of Jude Antoine. He's saying, you can be a bishop, you can be a priest, you can be a cardinal, you can even be a pope, but you are not a disciple of Jesus Christ. You are not a disciple of Jesus Christ. I'm just going to skip through to the end of the message. And then he picks up this message, yeah? He picks up this message later on in his pontificate when he speaks about the importance of becoming a disciple, but not just a disciple, but a missionary disciple. He says, by virtue of baptism, we have been made missionary disciples. Evangelii Gaudium, the joy of the gospel, number 120. All the baptized, whatever their position in the church or level of instructions, are agents of evangelization. You are missionary. You are agent of evangelization. You need to make disciples. He goes on to say, the new evangelization calls for personal involvement from everyone, the whole of the people of God, a new kind of personal involvement on the part of the baptized. The people of God are a disciple people who receive their faith, and a missionary people because they transmit the faith. All of us in the church are disciples. Say amen. Amen. All of us in the church are disciples, and we are forever, our whole life long, we are all missionaries, each in the place the Lord has assigned him to be. Even the littlest one is a missionary. Even the greatest one is a disciple. But one might say, bishops are not disciples. Bishops knows everything. The Pope knows everything. He is not a disciple. Pope Francis says, no. The bishop and the Pope must also be disciples. Because if they are not disciples, they do no good. They cannot be missionary. They cannot transmit the faith. We must all be disciples and missionary. Then he goes on to indicate how the church in Japan was faced with tremendous persecution. The Catholic community in Japan in the 17th century faced tremendous amount of persecution. Martyrs Many of the priests were expelled. Thousands of the faithful were killed. No more priests was left in Japan. All the priests were expelled. The community, Catholic community, retreated to hiding, keeping their faith in secret. And for 250 years, there was no priest in Japan. But when the priest came back after 250 years, all the faithful were baptized. Why? Because the lay people who were left baptized their own children. Missionaries, disciples. Disciples making disciples. Say amen. Amen. Give the Lord a hand. Friend, don't wait for what happened in Japan to happen to you. Say amen. Amen. Now become disciples. Would you stand to your feet? Discipleship is a commitment to follow the Lord. Jesus issued the call, come follow me and I will make you fishers of men. You need to move on beyond milk to solid food.